Hey guys, it's Brant, and I'm back with another The Panel Has Spoken video. And today I have my trusty partner in crime.
Partners in crime!
Yeah, Rick there. And today we have a special guest. We have That Toy Bonnie Guy, and we're going to call him Bonnie today, but this is That Toy Bonnie Guy.
Hi, everyone.
He's been a fan of the channel for a while. We've done videos of Striper, reviewing Striper albums. I'm a huge Striper fan, and so we've done that. He's a huge Striper fan, and so we've done that back in the day, and we need to get some more done sometime. So, you know, it's just been real busy, but we'll get some more done. So be sure to check him out on his channel. He's on YouTube, That Toy Bonnie Guy, and he's usually in the comments too. He's a panel member. He's been one since almost the very beginning, if not since the beginning.
Since the very beginning.
Yeah, so it's good to have you, man. So
very good.
Yeah, so I'm going to talk about Dynasty today, and I want to go ahead and lead off talking a little bit about our experiences with Dynasty, or what Dynasty means to us. And yes, since you're the guest, we'll let you go ahead and start first.
Oh, well, I got into Kiss last year in February after my 16th birthday, and I was looking through the albums they have, from the first album, Dressed to Kill, Alive. I saw the cover for Dynasty, the cover of the album. I was like, that's a really cool cover. I picked up that album, listened to it, and when I first heard I Was Made for Love and Yellows, I was like kind of confused, because why is a hard rock band doing a disco song? That was back in the day. Why are kids doing a disco song? But then I listened to the whole album, was like really impressed. There was a couple of songs I didn't like on that album, but overall it was a great song, and it took me a long time to like I Was Made for Love and Yellows. I'm one of those people that said like, well, someday I'll like I Was Made for Loving You. Now I absolutely love I Was Made for Loving You.
Yeah, I Was Made for Loving You is one of those songs that may have to grow on you, or you may grow out of.
I also got the 2014 reissue. I gave the poster to my girlfriend. My girlfriend has the poster now, and I got the album on vinyl.
It's awesome. So, Rick, what about you?
My sophomore year of high school, I was 15. My friend Danny had gotten me into Kiss, and my friend Brett. And so that Christmas, we decided to give each other compact disc, you know, Kiss CDs. And Danny gave me Dynasty, this very Dynasty right here. Still have it. And that Christmas break, I just fell in love with this record. This record is tied with my number one. My two favorite records are Rock and Roll Over and Dynasty. And if you were to say I could only keep one album, I think I would choose Dynasty. This panel was super hard for me to decide. Every song's a number one for me.
Same.
Every song's a number one. And
well, I take that back. I only hate one song.
It was very hard for me to rank them. And but man, I love this record. So good.
That's awesome. Yeah, I knew this was going to be a popular panel album, and I knew it was going to be very difficult for people, and that's going to show in the scoring, because the scoring is very evenly based, and I was very surprised at the result of this panel. It just kind of, whenever I sat back and I looked at the results, I actually went back and did a recount just to make sure. But it's pretty decisive, but it's also pretty level. Before we get into that, my experience with Dynasty, this was a huge album for me. I was 10 when this album came out. This is the first Kiss album that I bought with my own money.
The Return of Kiss.
And it was 2 years since Love Gun. And it felt like forever before this album came out. And when you're young, time seems to you, you have a different concept of time when you're young than you do when you're old.
That's true. Very true.
And so it seemed like forever. And I remember going down to J. Joe's Records with my mom every weekend and asking the person, is the Kiss album out? Hadn't heard anything. And there was the rumors that they were going to break up because of the solo albums. And it was already started with Peter, and all this stuff was Peter was actually already working on his solo album when he was making this album, he was already working on it. But I remember this is the album that I went down to the record store and bought with my handed my money and got the album, went home and pulled out the huge poster, just looked at it and listened to the album. And I remember being not being upset at the song I Was Made for Loving You. I didn't have a concept. My musical world back then was very much a fishbowl. I listened to who I listened to, and I didn't really recognize people outside of that. So I really didn't have a concept of what disco was at the time. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't a disco album to me. I didn't realize that it was a disco album until, it's not a disco album to me. There's a disco-esque song on it, and that was intended because Paul was tearing up Studio 54. And it was the time everybody, Kiss was kind of following along a trend. It begun the era of them following along with trends for better or for worse. But this album is really good. Ace really shines on this album. But I just remember this album being, it's a huge staple in Kiss 3 for me. Now, as far as the panel goes.
Real quick, can I ask, what was it like holding that cover as a 10-year-old? Because this was the first, actual picture cover. I mean, Alive 2 had pictures on it. But
it was so close. First...
I want to ask something, but I'll leave it for later. Yeah. I want to ask something. The tour, that's a quick question. What do you think about the 4 solo songs played on the tour? I personally think they were okay, but I was upset they removed Radioactive and Tossing and Turning. They were awesome. I don't know why they removed them.
Yeah, I remember when I saw, because I also saw this tour. This was the first concert I ever went to in Charlotte, North Carolina, 10 years old. And I have a video. I thought I'd actually shot and released this video. Rick, remember I told you about this in private messages about where I went down to that place in Charlotte during the Christmas show back in November. And it's right next to the arena where I saw Kiss and Rat and Motley Crue and Metallica back in the day. I thought I shot and released that video, but I looked and I was scrolling down through my videos the other day and saw that I never put it out. So shortly after this video comes out, I'll be putting out, probably in a week or so, I'll be putting out a video of where I saw Kiss for the very first time.
That'd be awesome.
I think I've saw Kiss 13, 14 awesome. Times so far. I haven't seen them since the Farewell Tour. I've not seen them on the End of the Road Tour. And they just played.
The true End of the Road Tour was the Farewell Tour.
I remember the concert. I remember liking that the solo album songs were there. It made sense that the solo album, because they didn't tour for the solo albums. Uh-huh. A solo album's tour, and I remember, this is something I've never told you, Rick, but we talk about the things you think of as kids. I remember being a kid thinking, okay, when are they going to announce the solo album's tour?
Can you imagine how much fun that would be?
That would have been cool if they would have did a show that was all solo album songs. That would have been awesome. But they didn't. So it just made the wait even longer to get to Dynasty. And Kiss was still hyped up. All the stuff like the Tom Schneider show and all the, you see all the stuff on 2020 and all these things. Kiss was really hyped up. They were a well-oiled machine by this time that was also in dysfunctional disarray, falling apart because of Peter shenanigans and Ace feeling like he was being boxed in and wanting to spread his wings. Plus, he is also...
The end of the tour was bad because I read some stories that Peter stopped playing the drums on Move On because he hit himself with one of the drumsticks, and then he came back and the floodlights turned on and the concert was stopped for 15 minutes and then it went back to normal.
Yeah, speeding up, slowing down. Him and Paul...
That was terrible.
If I wasn't that concert, I would be like, oh, fuck this concert. I'm out of here.
Yeah, I think that was the straw that broke the camel's back with Paul. And I think that's why Paul holds the content towards Peter that he does, was because Kiss is Paul's baby and Paul is Kiss and he's the one that's kept it alive. And I know we're getting off on a big tangent, but a lot of this stuff that came to a head with Dynasty. So I guess it's okay to talk about it. But Paul held a lot of content towards Peter because he said in an interview, families can have disagreements back backstage in private. But when you bring it out in front of the fans, mm-hmm. and you air the dirty laundry in front of the fans, is when mm-hmm. that was the last straw with Paul. Paul was like, it's time, you know.
Yeah, and you have to remember also, this was the era of money and drugs and ego and fame and all that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a four-way marriage and it tears it apart.
True.
But yeah, it really was a destructive time for Kiss. There was a lot of inner turmoil going on, a lot of ego, a lot of substance abuse. Peter only plays on one song on the album. Anton Figg takes over on the other. And
rumor circulated that Richie Fontana played on "I Was Made for Loving You" instead of Anton Figg. That's not true. Yeah. Actually, Richie Fontana is the drummer on Paul's solo album.
Yeah, and I heard somebody say they did a nice "What If." They're like, "What if?" Kiss would have hired Anton Figg rather than Eric Carr. And to me, I don't know why they didn't. I mean, Anton Figg is an amazing drummer. Nothing against Eric. I love Eric to death.
It probably had to do with his looks.
Just like mm-hmm. I said, it had to do with Bob Kulick, why Bob didn't get the job. Kiss was very vain at the time, and it had to do with looks. They wanted somebody that could play the part and look the part, and Anton Figg didn't look the part.
And they were so big on Eric shaving his mustache.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. So anyway, it's a very celebrated time. It's a very awesome time. This is an awesome album. And this one's hard for me. There's 9 tracks on the album. And every song on this album feels kind of long. Have you noticed that? That they don't feel short. Every song feels kind of long. There's some that's definitely longer than others. That's why it only has a runtime of 9 tracks. But even every song feels long. I think they're all very well constructed. I think they're all well thought out. There was a lot of people, as far as what the panelists were saying, what I was saying earlier, is they were all over the place. Some people loved Ace's songs. Some people hated his songs. Some people loved Gene's songs, hated Gene's songs.
I was looking at the list, and some people have "I Was Made for Loving You" at the very bottom. No disrespect to anybody, but I feel a little bit upset because that's some rules.
I didn't look at the list, but I'm going in predicting that everyone's gonna love Ace.
Yeah, I mean, and a lot of people, they like said, they was like, and the one thing that they said, Gene didn't get enough songs. One song was enough for Peter. Peter didn't need a song at all if he wasn't even playing on the album. There was comments was all over the place.
Could you imagine if "By Myself" from "Out of Control" ended up on "Dynasty"?
I don't know, man. I mean, some of these songs sound like they are, and one person said it. I didn't take a note of who it was, but some of these songs, they sound like solo album leftovers. I don't want to say rejects, but solo album leftovers. Charisma could have been on Gene's solo album. Magic Touch could have been on Paul's solo album. It sounds exactly like it.
I'm giving too many of my ideas.
I didn't go back and look at my review that I did to see, because I break down in my reviews of albums that I did last year.
I watched it before getting on here.
I talk about who actually played on what, and I can't remember since you're so refreshed, Bonnie. Maybe you do. But on Ace's songs, Ace on here, he sounds like he's in his own little bubble, in his own little world. And it sounds like Ace's songs could have been on his solo album, because it mm-hmm. sounds like he played the guitar, the bass, and Anton Figg played the drums.
Only 2 songs. He only has Anton and himself on 2 songs, and we have Paul on "Save Your Love."
Yeah. So I mean, yeah, you can tell he's in the chorus, but yeah, it's like, it's almost like they were collecting, and Peter kind of worked on his own Gene. It almost sounds like these guys were making an album still. They were all making solo albums, but mm-hmm. then collectively putting the songs together to make Dynasty. And I always loved the name Dynasty. I always thought that Dynasty was awesome. And you were talking about the cover, Rick. I remember whenever I bought this album, I also bought the poster, the big, huge poster of the cover. And it's larger than life. And I remember laying that poster on the floor of my bedroom.
Also, fun fact, the reason they're wearing the black shirts is because the costumes weren't ready at the time when they shot that photo. That's why they're wearing the black shirts.
Yeah, well, they're actually a fun fact to go even further back than that was this is a deep jacket. This is a deep fun fact. They actually had on straight jackets, and the album was
Let's see. Why don't we do something for the kids? Have them in black shirts.
Right. And they were in straight jackets because this album was originally supposed to be called Asylum. An album that a title that they would use later on, but this album was originally supposed to be called Asylum, and they were just going to show their face because they weren't revealing their new costumes. They were going to show their faces up close on the front of the album, which is a hodgepodge Photoshop. It's an early Photoshop cropping. And then on the inside, they were going to be in the straight jackets because the album was going to be called Asylum. They nixed that idea. They blacked out the Asylum, the straight jackets, changed the name to Dynasty. And why can't Kiss get track listings right on the back of their albums?
Who knows? Who knows? And do any of you own the variant cover of the album?
Where you can see a little bit of the uncropping?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I do not. I've never ran across it.
You can see on mine, you can see a little bit of outside of Paul and Gene's hair, but it's not the variant.
The 2014 reissue has it a little bit because I was looking at the cover and I was like, oh, it's a little bit cropped in.
The easiest way to tell is to look at the A-track.
Yeah.
And that's the actual, the huge uncropped.
But I remember laying on the floor looking at the solo album. I mean, their eyes were this big on the solo album, so they were larger than life. And just studying, you could see Peter's pores in his face, and you could see the greatest detail in the makeup, and it still bugs.
Ace's edition of the blue.
Yeah, yeah, and it still bugs me that one of Peter's cat eyes is taller than the other. It kind of almost makes it look like he's giving one of those looks, because one's taller. It's like they're not perfectly drawn. But then if you go back and you look at Kiss makeup through the years, none of it was ever really perfectly drawn, even in, you know, intent photo shoots. It varied. But anyway, let's get to the panel here. All right, so we had 94 on this panel. I thought we were going to break 100.
Whoa!
Yeah, 94, including the three of us. 94 people. And so, I'm going to name them out really quick. So we have In My Head, It's All For You Demon, That Toy Bonnie Guy. And then from Facebook, Ray Kelly, Mark Hilliard, Scotty Sky, Matt Ucci, Scott Trussell, Joe Nail. Instagram, we have Gregory Pegg, Wasson Matthew, Metzel 5, Rocker L 0270, Tony P 1, Dylan Tucker, Bizbag 1969. From Twitter, Tom Dust, Katie Christina, Darren Helliwell, Tony Rod, Aladia.
Hi, Thomas.
Paul Teplius, Jack Skellington, Hank DeGraff, Dave Cranston, Eric Mosieu, Brian Balick, Bill Sharp, Sam Loomis, Horror Gal Susan. And if you haven't seen Horror Gal Susan's YouTube channel, check her out if you're a fan of horror. She's also a huge Kiss fan. Deuce, Andy, David King, Kirk 5150, Jeff Wyatt, Luis Fernando, Ace Van Deuce, Vincent Marone, author, Steve, Michael Backford, Justin Hall, Kristen, Sterlino, Greg Troyan, D88 Racing, Mitchell, and then YouTube, John B. Good, George Doley, Trevor Bullock, Les Wadley, Lee Gerstmann, Sonic Riccardi, AJ Zetro, 1975, Emily Graziano, IndyCult 777, Jeremy Kimona, Rick R., John O., Keith Nidu, Kiss Crazy 80, Sandy Graziano, Dwight Manning, Perpetual Art, Robbie Stars, Jay Reed, Mark Stewart, Jay Reiner, Joe Pegg, Pins Fan 77, Greek Freak, Aiden Pro Dalton, Jay Lee, Golamine, Shea Basin, Two Gay Dads, Michael D., Brian Stacy, Man With No Name, Sublime 130, Kiss Carolina, Hard Rock Metalhead, Dark Light, Steve Rivas, Young and Wasted, Mix C, Horror and Pop Culture, Vapor Man, Super Kiss 1200, Tom S., Guitar Man, John Howard, Travis Mulgard, Orville Dunworth, Paul Bortolino, Brady McCatherine, The Matthew Smith, and 3SV1333. So, there we go. And Matthew Smith's name isn't the Matthew Smith. I just always say that to give him hell.
I want to give a shout out real quick to Emily Graziano. Watch the video that you made with Brands. It was a really good shout out.
Yeah, and Emily's going to be back. And Sandy Graziano, if you're watching this video, I'm asking you personally, as a favor to all of us KISS fans, we want to see more. Get that other tote out of your crawl space. We want to see it. We want to see it. So, yes, it was a pleasure having Emily on. And I heard that her mom might even make a cameo in the next video with Emily. So that'd be really cool. I know her mom's really shy and that's not really her thing. But it'd be nice to put a face with the name. Anyway, so let's get into this 94 panel wide dynasty scoring list because they have spoken and we do have a number one. So we're going to start with number 9. So Bonnie, you're the guest. What do you predict the panel is going to pick for number 9?
All right, let me go check. I predicted the panel was going to choose number 9, X-Ray Eyes, because I feel it's one of those songs that it feels like, why are you writing a song about something stupid?
Okay. I think Gene was trying to further his superhero image. You know, not only is the demon and spit blood and fire, but he also has X-ray eyes. But Paul was the one that shot stuff out of his eyes in Dynasty, so it was, or in Kiss Meets the Phantom, so it was confusing for a 10-year-old kid.
That's true.
So what about you, Rick? What do you predict at night?
This isn't my personal thought, but I thought the panelists would choose I Was Made for Loving You.
Okay. I thought my prediction was that Peter was going to get slighted and that the panel was going to choose Dirty Living. That's not my prediction, but that's not my pick, but that's what I thought they were going to pick. So with 295 points, the panelists chose at number 9, X-Ray Eyes.
Mm.
Two panelists, Rick R. and Tom Dust, picked this song as their favorite. And Tom actually even said that he knew that X-Ray Eyes was not a fan favorite, but he loves it. And this is a song for me. I picked this as my least favorite. This is probably, although I don't hate any track on Dynasty, I don't skip any track.
Yeah, that's fine, don't worry.
I love every track.
Same.
It's just, I don't know what it is about X-Ray Eyes. I just never could get into it. I did like that it had the piano in it. And this song sounds like it belongs on Gene's solo album. This song would have made Gene's solo album better, in my opinion. If it had been on his solo album, I probably would have liked it more. But there's some tough songs it's stacked up against on this album. And Somebody's Got to Be Last. So, in my opinion, it's X-Ray Eyes. So, Bonnie, where'd you pick X-Ray Eyes for you?
Okay, so I got a fun fact. I originally placed it on number 9 at first, but then one morning I was listening to Dynasty and the riff of X-Ray Eyes caught me. I was like, it's a pretty cool riff. So I moved it and placed it on number 7. It's my 7th favorite of the album.
Okay. Rick?
How about you, Rick?
I picked it at number 5. I totally agree with you, Brant. If Magic Touch is a Paul solo song, X-Ray Eyes is a Gene solo song. And you add in those disco sound effects, I'm sold. And I love this song. It may not be Ace playing the solo, but the solo to this song is very Ace.
Mm-hmm. So that takes us to number 8. So what's prediction for number 8, Bonnie?
Okay, at number 8, I predicted the panel was going to choose Sure Know Something.
Okay.
I've never been a fan of Sure Know Something. I don't like that song. It's so poppy and reminds me of modern day artists. I really never liked it. It's really boring to me. It's one of those songs I really don't like on Dynasty. Well, I said I love every song on that one, but there's two songs I don't like. Sure Know Something is one of them. Anyway, are you ready?
I chose that the panel would choose Dirty Living at number 9.
I thought that the panel was going to choose, if they were going to choose an Ace song low, that it was going to be this one.
Save Your Love.
Save Your Love is what I predicted that they would pick as number 8. So that's what I thought. And at 402 points, so 9 was 275 X-Ray Eyes, so that's definitively the bottom because number 8 jumps to 402. But at 402 points, the panel chose for number 8, Save Your Love. So I was right. 7 panelists, Scotty Sky, Deuce, Luis Fernando, Les Wadley, IndyCult777, Mark Stewart, Gulamine Chabstain picked this as their favorite song. Me, I picked Save Your Love as my 5th. It is my, out of the songs that Ace has on here, out of the 3 songs he has on here, it's my least favorite of the 3, but I still love it. What I don't like about it is the same thing I've heard Ace say he don't like about it, is he said that the chorus gives him a headache. Because it goes into that double time. Da 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 da. Yeah. That save it. Save it. Save your love. Save it. Save it.
I can tell it's Paul.
Yeah, you can tell it's Paul. And I don't this is one of those songs that I wish it would have been on his solo album, because this is totally a Ace solo album song. And I would have liked to heard how it would have been done on Ace's solo album without Paul in the background. It's one of those things I've been curious to hear. But, yeah, so I picked this as my 5th favorite. What about you, Bonnie?
I picked it as my 3rd favorite, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. I love this song. It's one of my personal favorite songs on the album. I love Face's guitar on this song. I love the chorus. I don't have a problem with the chorus. I think the chorus is just fine. Mm-hmm. Though I would say Paul would have been well edited out of that chorus. I would have preferred Ace to sing it himself.
Yeah, to me, I ranked this at number 8. Again, every song's a number 1 for me, but I had to put it at number 8. To me, it's perfect Ace. It's simple guitar, simple melody, simple lyrics. The chorus does get too repetitive. Mm-hmm. But 2 things I absolutely love. Classic Ace guitar solo with that da-da-da-da. Oh, yeah. Yes.
I was getting ready to say the solo.
Oh my gosh. You know, we hadn't heard that since the Alive solo.
Yeah.
You know, and oh man, just
clicking the toggle switch.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Then, yeah.
Then that bridge, mm-hmm, where he just, the girl, you know it's over. Mm-hmm. We had some good times.
They're gone. And now they're gone.
Perfect.
So long.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it is. It is. Like I said, it's and 5 for me, this whole album, like, there's really only one song, and I've already said what it is, that is definitely my bottom. But the rest of them, they're all number ones. They're all, it's just, you got to put them in an order, you know? Yeah. But yeah,
I got 2. I took what you said, Brent. You have only one song that you hate. I have 2, actually.
Well, I don't hate them. Don't get me wrong. When I say just because it's the bottom, don't mean. I mean, there's other Kiss songs I hate. I don't hate X-Ray Eyes. Okay, so that brings us up to number 7. So, Bonnie, what you got panel wise prediction for number 7?
Okay, at number 7, I predicted the panel was going to choose Magic Touch.
Okay.
I said that the panel was going to choose X-Ray Eyes.
I'm with you, Rick. I picked, if they're going to pick a Gene song at the bottom, that's when I tried to start doing it. Towards the bottom, I was like, okay, if they're going to pick a member song at the bottom, what's it going to be? I figured Peter's, mm-hmm, would be at the bottom, Save Your Love for Ace would be at the bottom. And when it come to Gene, I thought that X-Ray Eyes would be towards the bottom. So I picked X-Ray Eyes as what the panel's going to pick for number 7. So at 437 points, we're still in the 400s, but we didn't go up much. 437 points at number 7, the panel chose, and here it is, I Was Made for Loving You.
I'm not shocked.
I'm not shocked either. Actually, Bonnie, when I saw it that low, I wasn't shocked. I saw this, I didn't mention it earlier, but a lot of, in the comments, if you look, people that were Kiss fans that were maybe my age or a little older than me, like 2 or 3 years older than me, that when I was 10, they were 13, 14. When this album came out, they checked out. They were done. They're like, nope, no more Kiss for me. They were done with it. Many, many panelists said, this is the album that I checked out on. And that happened a lot with a lot of the hardcore fans. Kiss gained a lot of fans, but they lost a lot of hardcore fans. And this song was one of the songs that did it. And this is the song that put the big, huge blemish and bruise on this album for a lot of fans. It didn't for me, but for a lot of fans. And so that's one of the reasons why it's so low. Another reason is fatigue. They play this show, this song on the End of the Road tour right now. It's not one of the songs they should be playing on the End of the Road tour. They should be playing something else. But we did have 11 panelists that love this song, so let's give them their due. One, we have a member here. But as far as 11 panelists, we have Tony P, Sam Loomis, Hargal Susan, David King, Ace Van Deuce, Emily Graziano, Sandy Graziano, Greek Freak, Aiden Pro Dalton, and Dark Light, and Mr. Toy Bonnie himself. I'll pick this song as their number one. I picked this as my sixth favorite song on the album. I love I Was Made for Loving You. I don't want to see them perform it live. I like this. My favorite recorded live version of I Was Made for Loving You is the Australia.
Alive 3.
Yeah, Alive 3 is good too. He sings it differently. When he sings it in the upper register, and he sings it in a different melody. But I love this song. I like the solo on it, even though it's very short. But I always liked I Was Made for Loving You. I even like the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do's, you know. They had Baby Shark beat back in 1979, you know.
Oh, dear God.
But anyway, so I Was Made for Loving You. I don't have a problem with it. I picked it as six. That could have just well as been three or four or five for me. It wouldn't have been a top three. I Was Made for Loving You was not a top three song for me. So, but I still like it. So what about you, Bonnie? I know you picked it, but tell us why. I know you like a ballad, and it's not a ballad, so.
I'm most notably known for loving ballads, but I Was Made for Loving You. I have a funny story about I Was Made for Loving You. I think it was my second week of school last year. My friends started singing the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I was like, what Kiss song is that? I Was Made for Loving You. All right, so I went home after that day of school, put on my headphones, picked I Was Made for Loving You. I heard it. Was not impressed because, like I said, why are they doing a disco song? After three or four listens, the riff kind of got me.
I love that bass. I love that bass. That
the bass.
That's amazing.
Also, I'm not a fan of the single version because they cut out the bass intro, and it really bugs me that they cut it out. I love it fully when they play it fully on the song. And yeah, I love it. I love it so much because now my friends love it. I love it. Everybody loves this song. Well, except a couple of people I know, but yeah. Also, I prefer the Australia live version because Eric Carr plays it very, very fast. And
Eric Carr played everything fast.
Yeah, they played it very fast. And I was like, that's how it should sound. It should have been like that. It's shorter, I know, but the way that they played it, it was 100% perfect. That's why I love how it's made for Loving You. If they played it on the same way they played it on the album with the keyboards and everything, it would have been perfect for me. But that video in Australia is fun for me, and they played it fast. So, yeah, that's why I picked it number one.
I picked it at number six also, Brant. To me, this is Roller Rink Glory. You know, this is the reason that the France 45 for this song says disco rock, which I love it.
I forgot to talk about that. Thank you for mentioning that. I also love the seven minute disco remix they did to I Was for Loving You. I uploaded it to my channel. If you guys haven't seen it, I uploaded it to my channel. It's awesome. I really love it.
Oh yeah. And yeah, like the France 45 says disco rock. Bonnie just mentioned the disco single, the 12 inch. So much fun. And I just remember hearing, to me, I was a brand new fan, pretty much like 3 years in, 4 years in when Alive 3 came out. And to hear this song on a live three, to me, was bizarre. Like, it was like we shouldn't be hearing this. And
is that the 12-inch single, the disco?
That's a German version too, right?
Mm-hmm. It's a German version with "I Was Made for Loving You" and "Hard Times" from Germany.
Is that the disco mix?
It's only 4:29, so it's not the disco mix. It's just the maxi single. It's from Germany. It's one of those albums that started me down my German rabbit hole collecting.
That's beautiful.
I do have the 12-inch single, but on the Psycho Circus, because it was reissued when Psycho Circus was released, they included it with "In Your Face."
Mm. It basically looks the same on the front and the back.
That's sweet. Yeah, and I just remember when this song appeared on Alive 3, to me it was heavy, and it was that Creature, or that Revenge era.
Yeah.
Good.
And yeah, there's something about that because when they play it live, they try to take away the disco elements and play it like a hard rock song.
It had like a brooding to it, like a chugga chugga chugga
chugga chugga chugga. And especially on Alive 3, it had that revenge anger to it. Mm-hmm. I mean, that crunch and I love that revenge era lineup. Yeah.
All right, so we finished our thoughts on "I Was Made for Loving You," so we're gonna move up to number 6, one track out of the top 5. So, Bonnie, what do you predict for number 6 for the panel?
All right, at number 6, we got Dirty Living. I picked Dirty Living as number 6, what the panel's going to choose.
Okay.
I said the panel would choose Magic Touch.
All right. And I predicted that the panel was going to choose Hard Times. And the reason why I picked Hard Times is I know a lot of people like it, but I felt like there would be more popularity for the 5 songs above it. And so it just got nudged slightly out of the top 5 for me. So that's what I thought the panel was going to pick, was Ace's Hard Times. And with 449 votes, not much above number 7, but with 449 votes at number 6, the panel chose Dirty Living. So who picked Dirty Living?
I did.
Bonnie, yeah, so Bonnie, you got it right. We need to start keeping score of who gets stuff right. Dirty Living, 13 panelists, Mark Hilliard, Gregory Pegg, Michael Bagford, Christian, John B. Good, George Doley, Trevor Bullock, Kiss Crazy 80, Joel Pegg, Young and Wasted, Mick C. Horror and Pop Culture, Brady McCatherine, 3SV 1333, all picked Dirty Living as their favorite. Which it kind of shocked me that Dirty Living would make it this high. I thought Dirty Living
Same.
Was gonna, I thought it was going to be near the bottom.
I thought it was going to be like a 5 or 6, somewhere around that area. But wow, it got a lot of support. Yeah. Fans really love Dirty Living.
Yeah, so I picked this, and it's not a reflection on the song. This is actually one of my favorite Peter songs outside of his solo album. But I picked this number 8. Just above X-Ray Eyes, because there's just so many better songs to me above it. But I love this song. A lot of people pointing out the same things that I love about it. All the references that Peter makes to "I Gotta Get Away," "Mainline Out of China," you know, all the references to previous songs that he includes in the lyrics. But I remember being a kid when I talked about when I listened to Paul's album, when he had the song "Goodbye," and I thought, oh crap, that's Kiss is breaking up because Paul's saying goodbye, or he's leaving Kiss. And then you hear Dirty Living saying, Peter's saying, "I gotta get away. You know, I gotta set myself free. I can't wait any longer to set myself free."
Dirty Living is basically Kiss's Glass Onion. If you're a Beatles fan, then you get what Glass Onion. Dirty Living is Kiss's Glass Onion.
Yeah.
That's always.
But I think this was where Peter's headspace was at, because if you go back, and this is a very old song. This is from Lips, Chelsea period. It's a very old song. Yeah, but he rewrote the lyrics in it, because the lyrics are not this. You can find the lyric. You can find the original online. But
I heard it online in a different way, different than the one we got.
So he rewrote it to basically where his headspace was at the time. And Peter was frustrated, just as frustrated as Ace was. And so he was ready to do his own thing. And he had actually, his solo album was kind of the kickstart of his solo career that would, you know, be kind of assisted by Paul and Gene when they fire him. But yeah, so for me, Dirty Living is an 8, but I still love the song. I think it's great.
All right, so for me, I placed it on number 6. Yeah, 6 correctly. At first, it was one of my least favorite songs on the album. I never liked it at first, but then I listened to it a couple of times, and the riff kind of got me. And I also got a thought that this is Peter's last song. I gotta say that this was Peter's last song with Kiss. First tenure, because second tenure didn't start until 16 years later. And yeah, it's a pretty good song for him to say goodbye to the Kiss wagon that's already going out. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I say get rid of I Finally Found My Way and put this song as the last Peter song, Kiss song. So yeah, I placed it at number 6.
Is that that horrible song from Detroit Rock City?
I Finally Found My Way from Psycho Circus.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's a very good thought, though. That would be, Dirty Living would be the perfect last Peter song. It's my number 2. I love this song. My all-time favorite Peter song. I love the 12-inch German.
I also wonder, what if they played it live? Because this song was apparently rehearsed, but it was never played live.
Oh, this would have been so much better live than Tossin' and Turnin', mm-hmm. to me.
And also Hooligan. Hooligan live sounds horrible.
I love the vibrato guitar in this song after the choruses. You can totally picture those classic shots of Ace, like with his mouth open, playing.
Also, a funny story about the 12-inch single, the disco single. I actually put it, I was in a party and I put that song on. I started dancing. It was like, you are John Travolta, aren't you?
Yeah, I've always loved Dirty Livin'. My all-time favorite Peter song came in at number 2 for me.
Okay.
My favorite version of Dirty Livin' is the disco song version, the disco version. Yeah. The original one is better. The original one is good, but I prefer the disco version better than the original.
Me too.
Yeah, when it comes to disco, the two songs on this album that basically throw disco in your face is I Was Made for Loving You and Dirty Livin'. They both have that steady, what they call the disco beat, the 4 on the floor.
Yep.
They have that steady disco beat to them, and, you know, makes you want to do that. All right, so top 5. What do you think about number 5, Bonnie?
All right, at number 5, I thought the panel was going to choose What Is My Charisma?
I thought the panel would choose Sure Know Something at number 5.
I thought that the panel was going to choose the first Paul song that I thought was the weakest, that they were going to choose Magic Touch. But at 485 points, the panelist chose at number 5, Hard Times.
Oh.
So 5 panelists, Sterlino, Lee Gerstmann, Keith Nidu, Jay Reiner, and Brian Stacey, picked this as their favorite. I picked Hard Times as my second favorite. I freaking love Hard Times. I love the drums. I love the drums in Hard Times. I love Ace's, the way he comes out singing hot. Well, I recall days in the city. I love when Ace sings like that. And I love the offbeat. And the drum, there's just so much offbeat stuff going on at the beginning of this song. I like, it's got the little and it's got the whistle blowing in it. The sound effects in it are just amazing. Yeah, I love Hard Times.
As a drummer, how could you not love this song?
When he breaks into the chorus, that riff that's under the chorus is so metal. That da 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 da.
I'm a bass player. Yeah. I'm a bass player, but the drums on this song sound good.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, Hard Times is a rock song. When people say, "Oh, it's a disco album," I'm like, "Really? Really?
No, it's not a disco album.
Really? Hard Times is." I'm like, "Oh, do you think this is a disco album? Let me play you 2 songs off this album that will show you this isn't a disco album." and fortunately, they're both by the same guy. So, Hard Times is second, is a second for me. This is where I start drinking the blue Kool-Aid. Yeah. All right, so what about you, Bonnie? Where'd you pick Hard Times at?
Hard Times, I placed it at number 4. I love this song. Ace in this song rips it out. I love when he says, "I don't want to be there or even think back." That part. Awesome. I love that
part. I chose, and I'm going to kind of be opposite of you guys. I don't hate the song, but I chose it at number 9 because to me, the riff is a little too generic. It's, you know, it was a little too generic, but it's Simple Ace, and that's not a bad thing. It's just Simple Ace. And had Peter done another song on this record, as Ace and Peter are both street guys, how cool would it have been if Ace and Peter both sang this song?
Yeah.
I thought this would be the perfect subject for Peter to join Ace in. And that, man, that would have been, how cool would that have been?
And Ace Ace wrote a lot of Peter's songs in the beginning. So I think it'd be really cool. I was sitting here while you were talking, and see, that's what I love about these things. I've never thought about that. That's what I love about it. Because I'm sitting here going, you know what? I could replace Ace's voice with Peter's voice in this whole song.
Mm-hmm.
I can hear it. So yeah, I mean, that'd be cool. It would have been cool to have one song where Peter and Ace did what Gene and Paul does, where they trade vocals.
Oh man, that would have been
between
so much
Ace fun. And Peter, the complementary of their voice would be like salt and pepper, you know, because their voices are so distinct. Yes, Paul may have been the best singer in Kiss at one point in time, but they all have their distinct voices. But the thing that I love about Ace and Peter is if they have their distinct voices, Ace and Peter definitely have their distinct voices.
And that was the good thing about Kiss, is just like the Beatles. I mean, you had 4 different voices, and it worked.
Yeah.
I was a Beatles fan until last year when I got into Kiss. Diehard Beatles fan.
All right, so that takes us to number 4. And number 4, it starts seeing some separation between 4 and 5, and there's some separation between 4 and number 1. So let's get down to it. Predictions for number 4.
Okay, at number 4, I predicted the panel was going to choose Save Your Love.
Alright.
I said the panel was going to choose Charisma.
Alright. And I thought that the panel at number 4 was also going to choose Charisma. I think that Gene's songs was good, but they weren't some of the best songs on the album. That Paul and Ace's songs were better, and it was going to push Gene's down a little bit. But the panel chose at number 4 with 506 points, so we're breaking into the 500s. And I was sad to see this, but the panel chose at number 4 with 506 votes, Ace's 2000 Man.
Hmm.
9 panelists: Dylan Tucker, Scott Trussell, AJ's Retro, 1975, John O, Jay Reed, Two Gay Dads, Vapor Man, Travis Mulgard, picked 2000 Man as their favorite song. And if you're counting and the math don't add up, because I am the 9th panelist. Because 2000 Man is hands down, since I was 10 years old, the very first time I heard this album, 2000 Man is, has, and always will be my favorite song on this album. It's one of my favorite Ace songs. But I didn't know this was a cover when I was 10 years old. I didn't even know who the Stones was when I was 10 years old. So 2000 Man, my favorite song. It's long, but I just love it. I love 2000 Man. I always have. It is classic Ace. If somebody told me, play me an Ace song, man, it'd be real tempting to not this be the song that I pull out. Yeah. Because even though I love Shock Me and I love Rocket Ride, I think this is the song that people would get the most.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's got that New York groove to it.
Yeah. So 2000 Man's number 1 for me. What about for you, Bonnie?
All right, so I placed it on number 2.
All right.
I love it. I love 2000 Man. Now, funny story, I heard the Stones version before I got into the Kiss version, and man, it was not good. It was not
very, good. Very different.
It was acoustic-y, a very, very psychedelic feel to it, which I find very weird and very disturbing. Which I'm gonna say I'm not a fan of psychedelic songs except the songs on Sgt. Pepper, the Beatles album. But man, Ace did a great job remaking this song into a hard rock song. It sounds spacey. It sounds very good.
Yeah, I ranked it at number 7, and that's not a bad thing to me. It just had to go low on my list. This is Ace proving that he can take someone's song and make it his. Mm-hmm. And this riff, I mean, you talk about Ace inspiring guitarists. This riff had to do it too in 1979. I remember hearing this song and me being 19, 15, 17 years old, sitting down and trying to learn this riff. Such a good riff. I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall when Ace went into the room and told Paul that he wanted to do a Stones cover.
Yeah.
I would have loved to have seen the look on Paul's face, and then also the look on his face after he heard this version or the demo, because they had to blow.
Gene was impressed with it, by it.
Especially to put it as the second track on the record.
Exactly.
That's big.
That's huge. Two funny stories. Well, one thing that I think is extremely amazing and a funny story, to personal story about this song to me, is this solo is a classic Ace solo. This solo is 8 bars long. Just 8 bars. So simple, but classic. And it just kind of showed you that Ace was perfectly comfortable. You can hear the confidence in Ace coming off his solo album. I bet he walked into that studio and like, I ain't going to be laying on the floor in the dark singing any songs on this M&F album. I'm going to be making 3 of the best songs on this album. You know, and you're going to give me 3 songs on this album. Or, you know, or I'm going to go do my own thing because I have proven what I can do. And yeah, Paul and Gene had to recognize that.
I would have loved to.
Look at New Year Groove. It became a hit and they cry like little fucking bitches.
Yeah, I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall when Ace sat down and learned this.
Yeah.
Because he had to know he had something special.
Yeah. The other funny story is the lyric in here when he says, my wife still respects me even though I really misuse her. I'm having an affair with a random computer. Well, when I was a kid, I was 10 years old. Now think, 10-year-old brain. Now this is in 79 where computers didn't exist like they do today. And you didn't get lyric sheets in albums either. So you were, it was bad lip singing. Going along, but for the longest time when I was a kid, I don't know why, but when he says I'm having an affair with a random computer, I used to think, since it's Ace, why not say what I thought he was saying? I thought he was saying I'm having an affair with her grand uncle Utah. I am having an affair with her grand uncle Utah.
you need to make a shirt.
I thought he said, when I first heard 2000 Man, I thought he said with a random computer.
Computer.
I always, when I was 15, I thought they said Randall computer, and Randall I thought it computer. Was like. I thought it was like some sort of like
Teletubbies weren't even a thing back then.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Just the things a 10-year-old brain thinks. Number 3, top 3. If you plan along, you know which ones are left. So top 3, what's your prediction on number 3, Bonnie?
All right, at number 3, I predicted the panel was going to choose Hard Times.
I predicted 2000 Man.
I predicted 2000 Man as well. I thought that 2000 Man is a great song and I love it, but I didn't think it was going to make it to number 1 or number 2, but I thought it was going to be right up there. With 527 points, the panel chose at number 3, Magic Touch. 13 panelists, Wasson Matthew, Rocker L 0270, Darren Helliwell, Tony Rod, Paul Teplis, Bill Sharp, Steve, Robbie Starrs, Jay Lee, Michael D, Kiss, Carolina Hard Rock Metalhead, John Howard, Orville Dunworth picked it as their number one favorite song on the album. And I know this is going to sound, I know this is going to sound bad for me because, once again, I love most of the songs on this album. They're all ones, twos, threes for me. But I had to rank them. I love this song. I think it's a Paul Stanley Construction. I think it's a great song. But I picked it as number seven. But that's not bad. It's just that's where I had to put it. I think it's a great song. So what do you guys think?
I'm going to start.
Go ahead.
I'm going to say something that Ralph Vieira said when he was doing a track by track. Magic Touch is fucking terrible. I put it at number nine. I hate that song. I can't stand Magic Touch. I hate that song. I can't stand it. It's so boring, dull, and the guitar solo doesn't do anything. It's boring.
I
give it a zero.
I will raise a sword with you, Brant, and I will say I put it at number four. To me, it's classic Paul Stanley solo material. Mm-hmm. It's like you said in the Paul panel, he constructs a song. It's power, it's emotion, it's rock. It's great.
Yeah, it's definitely two of Paul's songs on here sound like they could have been done on his album. Now, of course, we know that Paul had basically exhausted almost all his songs. He had dipped his well almost dry with the solo album. You know, he wrote Goodbye at dinner or at lunch. So he was writing songs on the fly. So for Paul to have turned around and wrote the three songs that's on this album, that none of them are really bad, in my opinion, none of them are really bad. For him to have done that in the scope and the amount of time from his solo album to the recording of Dynasty is pretty amazing to me. I think the reason why Ace probably got three songs is I think Ace was on, well, one's a cover, but he still had to rearrange it. But two of them, I think Ace was in a creative zone. So Ace was like a juggernaut right now. And he was probably spitting out songs as fast as he could because he was just in that zone. So Paul was probably relieved to go, hey, yeah, I'm fine with just doing three songs. You're not going to do more than me.
Yeah.
But I'm fine.
Very interesting you say that because, and another reason why I like these panels too, this just entered my head when you said that. If you notice in the Unmasked era interviews, Ace and Paul really get along. Mm-hmm. I think Paul got a lot of respect for Ace on this record. Mm-hmm. I think Ace
He even cared when he wanted to quit in the Creatures era. He said, stay in the band, don't leave.
I think when Ace came in with this material, I think Paul was taken back by it and appreciated the hard work.
Mm-hmm. The hard work and the growth. Mm-hmm. The growth that Ace did from Shock Me to the songs on this album, which was only 2 years. Mm. He went from recording Shock Me, laying on his back in a dark studio by himself with nobody else there recording the vocals for it, to this. Mm-hmm. The growth there, he grew faster than anybody else in the band. Paul and Gene, they were always growing and always pushing themselves, especially Paul. But the growth was steady and it was stable and it was reliable. But Ace's growth was like almost vertical. He was just, once he got that confidence under his belt, Ace just, you know, took off. Mm-hmm. So that leaves just two left. What do you think for number two there, Bonnie?
Okay, and number two. Okay, you gotta remember that this is I'm a 21st century kid, so I predicted the panel was gonna choose I Was Made for Loving You, number two.
Okay.
I thought the panel would choose Hard Times.
Okay. I thought the panel for number two was gonna choose Sure Know Something. I think that Paul had the two songs that was the most, I think that the panel was gonna choose the most favorite on here, and it was gonna come down to two songs, and it, you know, apparently hasn't come down to two songs, because we already have two of those songs gone. So I thought that Sure Know Something was going to be the number two song. And what the panel picked at 553 points at number two is What Is My
Charisma.
And honestly, I'm happy to see that. I didn't expect Charisma up that high. I picked it at like four. I predicted it at four. I wasn't expecting to see Charisma up that high, but I remember I have always loved Charisma. From the very first time I heard it, that the way it starts, that little that drum at the beginning, and then totally Gene. And the way he sings it, is it my fortune or my fate?
Is it my fortune or my fate?
He does those, ha! I mean, it is totally Gene. It is just totally, totally Gene. It's a demon song. Howard Marks gave him the idea.
Yeah. Get rid of living in the sin and put charisma there.
Yeah. Asked him, what's your charisma? What is it about you? What is it that you've got? And Gene does what he does best. He took a little line or a little idea and constructed a song out of it. I love the solo in this out on this song. Real simple, but I love it. And 15 panelists love it too. So let's talk about them before we get into us. Raul Kelly, Joe Neal, Mezzle 5, Dave Cranston, Brian Balich, Andy, Kirk 5150, Vincent Marone Author, D88 Racing, Jeremy Kimona, Dwight Manning, Perpetual Art, Super Kiss 1200, Tom S. All picked this as their favorite. I picked it as my third favorite. It's right there with my number ones, my number one, number twos, which I've already mentioned. But I love Charisma. I've loved it since the day I heard it. It's a great song. So what about you, Bonnie? Where'd you pick Charisma for you?
I picked Charisma number five. I actually really love Charisma. It's a really great Gene song and the best one, in my opinion. X-Ray Eyes, yeah. I already talked about X-Ray Eyes. Charisma, best song. I love playing it on bass. I always imitate Gene's parts with the vocals and everything. I love the ending when it says, what is my, Charisma, Charisma. And yeah, I also love the fact that their business manager was the one that co-wrote the song with Gene. Mm-hmm. Howard Marks.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I chose this as number one. This is the song that sold me when I was 15. Like you said, Brant, this is perfect demon. Dracula isn't always scary. You know, sometimes Dracula is the seductive guy in the shadows, you know, that seduces the girl. And to me, that is this demon. You know, God of Thunder is the scary Dracula. This is the seductive Dracula. And I mean, it's the perfect song for the era too. Ego, money, fame,
and it was girls. This was also a Wicked Lester song at the very beginning. The riff is from taken from Wicked Lester song.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this song, you have to love the fact that, as I always put myself like in a little Brant shoes, you know, listening to records, like what would I have thought when I was 10 years old? I would have thought this is the first time we get to hear Gene Simmons, the demon from Phantom of the Park on a record. Mm-hmm. It's got that Phantom of the Park voice to it. And I love that.
Definitely. I just remember being a kid and this was, like you said, this was, too bad it was written after Phantom of the Park, because it would have been perfect to be in Phantom of the Park.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's definitely a Phantom of the Park era type song. All right, so if you've been playing along, you know what the number one is, but we're going to give our predictions anyway. So Bonnie, what did you think the panel was going to choose at number one?
All right, so at number one, I was predicted the panel was going to choose the classic 2000 Man.
See, and I also thought the panel was going to rate Ace super high, so I said Save Your Love from the panel.
I predicted that they were going to choose I Was Made for Loving You. Even with the fatigue and the people not liking it and stuff like that, I guess I was just thinking that there was going to be enough. This is my thought process, guys. I'm a very analytical person. I was thinking that I knew Dynasty panel was going to be big, and it was. It's the largest one. And I also thought it might from Twitter and from YouTube, especially from Twitter, that it would bring in enough casual fans that would be like, oh, I was made for loving you. Because, you know, that's the song that they know. So I just thought that this was going to pull in the most casual fans and it was going to push it to the top. But I was wrong. At 595 points, though, it's pretty definitive. At 595 points, the panel chose at number one, Sure Know Something. And that shocked the crap out of me that Sure Know Something.
I'm shocked.
Sure Know Something. Out of 2000 Man, out of Charisma. And
I Was Made for Loving You.
I Was Made for Loving You. No. The panel, we collectively chose Sure Know Something. 19 panelists picked this as their favorite song. Almost a third. Matt Ucci, Bizbag 1969, Katie Christina, Ala Dio, Jack Skellington, Hank DeGraff, Eric Mosiu, Jeff Wyatt, Justin Hall, Greg Troyan, Mitchell, Sonic Regardi, Pids Fan 77, Man with No Name, Sublime 130, Steve Rivas, Guitar Man, Paul Bertolino, the Matthew Smith picked Sure Know Something as their favorite. I hear and Bonnie, if you don't love this song, being a bassist, because this has one of the best bass lines on this album. If you love this song for anything, you should love this song for the bass line. But for me, I picked this as my fourth favorite song on the album. I love Sure Know Something. To me, it's a Paul Stanley masterpiece. It could have been on his solo album, and I would have rather it been on his solo album than Hold Me, Touch Me. Sure Know Something would have been a great replacement on that album. I know Rick don't agree with me on that, because he's the AM radio king there, and he loves that song. But yeah, Sure Know Something for me, it's a great song. What about you, Bonnie?
All right, I picked it at number 8. I never liked Sure Know Something.
It surprises me with that bass line, though.
The bass line is good, yeah, I will admit, but it reminds me of a band that I really hate, of a song from a band I really, really hate. Imagine Dragons, Believer. I hate that song so badly. And that's why I never enjoyed this song. It's like, oh, it's a reference to Imagine Dragons. Imagine Dragons weren't a thing, obviously, but never liked it. That's my thing. Never liked this song. It's one of my two least favorite songs on the album. That's To Magic Touch. Those two songs are trash songs for me. I will throw them in the garbage and throw them down the toilet or something like that. Yeah. I would say.
Say how you really feel.
Put Psycho Circus or put Is That You? Put Shandy. Put, let's see, You're All That I Want. What Makes the World Go Round? But those two songs.
I don't know about some of those, man. All right, what about you, Rick?
I ranked Sure Know Something at number 3. I love this song. It's got that classic riff from Tonight You Belong to Me as the bass line. To me, it's just a perfect song from beginning to end. And Brant, you remember this. Remember in the pre-internet world when Extreme Close-Up came out and we got this video? Mm-hmm. That was huge. Mm-hmm. That was huge. It was like, holy crap, this is the video to Sure Know Something? I mean, so much fun. And I've always kind of viewed I Was Made for Loving You and Sure Know Something as sisters. You're set up with a blind date for I Was Made for Loving You. And Sure Know Something is her sister and she's hotter. That's how I look at these.
That is great. I love that. I love that analogy. That's what I love about these things, man. I live for Sunday mornings when I get to sit down and do these panels, man. Sunday mornings is just so great. So yeah. So there you have it, guys. That is it. So just to recap, the panel chose at number 9, X-Ray Eyes. At number 8, Save Your Love. At number 7, I Was Made for Loving You. At number 6, Dirty Living. Number 5, Hard Times. Number 4, 2000 Man. Number 3, Magic Touch. Number 2, Charisma. And number 1, Sure Know Something. So that is Dynasty, guys. So, you know the drill. By the time you see this, the panel has spoken. Post will already be posted on my social media.
Go to my
for Unmasked past
real week. Quick. Real quick, to all the panelists, I'm turning 17 on Wednesday, so wish me a happy birthday. I'm turning 17 on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah, for sure, for sure. Happy birthday early, dude. We'll be sure to do that. So, yeah, get down in the comments of this post and tell us what you think about how the panel turned out, and get into the comments on the post for Unmasked. You'll have from when this video comes out, which is going to be Monday, until midnight on Friday to get your list in. So get in. Let's talk about Unmasked. So anyway, that's all I've got. Toy Bonnie Guy, be sure to check him out. He's a huge Striper fan. He's got some great videos. I've been in a few. Be sure to go over to his channel. Give him some love. Give him a subscription. Give him a thumbs up. Click the notification bell so you get notified whenever he puts out new videos. He puts out good stuff. My partner in crime, do it for me, Bonnie.
Promise in crime.
There you go. Rick from It's All For You Demon. Thanks, Rick, as always.
Thank you, man.
And thank you to the viewers and to the panelists. Keep those subscriptions coming. Keep those comments coming. And we will see you in the next one. Take it easy.